What's changing in the deep abyss to cause mysterious sea creatures to emerge? Imagine standing by a tranquil beach when something otherworldly breaks the surface. The water stirs, and a silvery ribbon with fiery red fins undulates in the shadows. It's enormous, longer than a car, a creature that seems straight out of a sea serpent legend. You rub your eyes. Is this real? Oh yes. And you're not alone in your astonishment. In recent times, beachgoers around the world have witnessed mysterious deep-sea creatures venturing into sunlit waters. A 15-foot oarfish wriggling at the shoreline. A nightmarish anglerfish drifting under the midday sun. It feels like the deep ocean is knocking at our doorstep. Why are these creatures of the deep leaving their dark realm to visit us? Is something wrong in the oceans? Or are we simply seeing wonders that were always hidden? In this video, we'll dive into these thrilling sightings and explore the science that might explain why the ocean's most elusive creatures are suddenly making appearances near the surface. In Baja California Sur, Mexico, a group of stunned beachgoers captured footage of a rare oarfish swimming in knee-deep water. The video shows its iridescent, ribbon-like body and long, wispy crimson fins glinting in the sunlight. A sight so unbelievable that one onlooker exclaimed, "No one's going to believe this."
Yeah, that thing was cool.
Nobody's gonna believe this.
This doomsday fish, as folklore calls it, typically lives 660 to 3,300 feet deep in total darkness. Seeing it alive at the surface, gently coiling in the waves, was a once-in-a-lifetime spectacle, and a puzzling one. Just days earlier, and half a world away, another deep-sea giant made headlines. Off the coast of the Canary Islands, a deep-sea anglerfish, jet black with a gaping maw of razor teeth, was filmed swimming in broad daylight near Tenerife. This species, nicknamed the Black Sea Devil, is normally found between 650 and 6,500 feet below the surface, in the ocean's midnight zone. In fact, experts say it may have been the first time ever a live adult anglerfish was observed so close to the surface in daylight. The video, captured by marine biologists, shows the tiny, football-sized fish hovering in crystal blue water, its bioluminescent lure sticking out like a lantern. A nightmare made real under the sun. Both the oarfish and the anglerfish are creatures of the abyss, rarely seen by human eyes, let alone in shallow water. Their near simultaneous appearances have scientists and the public asking what on earth is happening. These aren't isolated incidents. In recent years, other bizarre deep-sea fish have popped up in places they don't belong. In 2021, not one, but three bloated Pacific football fish, a type of anglerfish with a spiky body and a headlamp, washed ashore in California. An incredibly unusual cluster for a fish so elusive. Wildlife officials were baffled, ultimately chalking up the coincidence to simple serendipity. But it left many wondering if something was changing in the deep Pacific. More recently, in spring 2023, dozens of fanged lancetfish, scaleless predators from a mile down, inexplicably stranded themselves along 200 miles of Oregon coast. Beachgoers found these prehistoric-looking fish with huge eyes and sail-like fins flopping in the surf, alive but far from home. "No one is sure why they are washing ashore," admitted Oregon state officials, calling it an area of open research. Some lancetfish may have chased prey too close to shore or fled a bigger predator, literally leaping out of the water in desperation. Others suspect that unusual ocean conditions or climate patterns in the Pacific are playing a role. Each of these encounters, whether an elegant oarfish in Mexico, a ghastly anglerfish in the Canaries, or a wave of lancetfish in Oregon, is thrilling, confusing, and a little bit haunting. These creatures usually live and die in the abyss, out of sight and reach. Now, they're turning up at our feet. To understand why, we first need to understand who these deep-sea visitors are and why they normally never leave their realm. So, why are such cases rising? One potential factor is the rapid changes in our oceans due to climate change. The deep sea might seem isolated, but it's intimately connected to the surface by chemistry and currents. As we pump greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, the oceans absorb over 90% of the excess heat. This has a cascade of effects. Warmer water holds less oxygen, and as the surface ocean warms, it forms a lighter layer that doesn't mix well with the cooler deep water. Imagine a lid sealing off the deep ocean from the above. Less oxygen from the air and surface gets transported downward. The result is expanding oxygen minimum zones in mid-depths, essentially growing swaths of deep water that are becoming oxygen-starved dead zones. Globally, the ocean has already lost an estimated 2% of its oxygen since the 1960s, and some regions have seen declines of 20 to 50% in deep oxygen. For creatures adapted to very stable conditions, this is a huge stress. Lack of oxygen, a condition called hypoxia, can force fish to flee their normal habitats in search of more breathable water. Marine biologists call this habitat compression. The livable layer for deep-sea animals shrinks, squeezing them into a narrower depth range. And when you squeeze a population, some individuals might spill out of their normal zone. In other words, a fish that usually stays comfortably at 1,000 feet might find that depth becoming uninhabitable due to low oxygen or higher temperatures, and it may move upward into unfamiliar, shallower waters. Mobile animals can sometimes move away from low oxygen areas, scientists note, but moving up comes with risks: more predators, warmer water. It might be the lesser of two evils. Could an oarfish or lancetfish appearing near the surface be a desperate attempt to find cooler, oxygenated water? It's plausible. When we see multiple deep fish stranding around the same time, we have to ask if an anomalous ocean condition is at play. For instance, the spring 2023 lancet strandings in Oregon coincided with unusual oceanographic patterns. Some experts hypothesize changes in ocean temperature or currents could be involved. Likewise, oarfish sightings have been speculatively linked to El Niño, a climate cycle that warms the Pacific and alters marine ecosystems. Climate change is making marine heat waves more frequent and intense, sometimes radically altering marine life distribution. While we don't have direct evidence that the oarfish came up because the deep sea is warming, the broader trend is that a changing climate is stressing ocean life at all levels. The deep sea, once thought buffered from surface warming, is feeling the effects too, slowly but steadily. This environmental stress could be one piece of the puzzle, causing deep sea creatures to appear in odd places. Another possible cause is ocean currents and upwelling events might physically transport deep sea creatures into shallow waters. The ocean isn't static. It's a dynamic conveyor belt of water masses. Sometimes, deep cold water can be pulled up toward the surface in what's called an upwelling, often bringing nutrients that fuel plankton blooms. If a fish accidentally wanders into an upwelling current, it might find itself swept upward much faster than it can normally swim. Storms and turbulence can similarly mix layers of the ocean. Picture an undersea landslide or a powerful storm surge injecting a rush of water upward. A fish could be carried along like a leaf in a fountain. In the case of the Canary Island anglerfish, researchers considered that an unusual current or eddy might have assisted its journey upward. The observers in Tenerife speculate its presence in such shallow water might be due to an upwelling current or other oceanographic anomaly. We also have to consider large-scale oscillations like El Niño, La Niña cycles. During El Niño, for example, the Pacific seas reduced cold upwelling in some areas and weird current shifts. During La Niña, the opposite. These cycles can displace marine animals from their usual ranges. Oarfish experts have suggested that El Niño and La Niña could explain an increase in oarfish sightings near coasts, perhaps by changing water temperatures and currents in the ocean's deep habitat. If an oarfish is used to a certain temperature at 1,000 feet and El Niño suddenly warms that layer, the fish might move shallower to find its preferred conditions, or get caught in a current it wouldn't normally encounter. Unprecedented currents can essentially escort deep creatures to the surface like unwitting tourists. It's a mechanical, environmental explanation that doesn't require the animal to choose to surface. It might be taken for a ride by Mother Nature. One of the most dramatic theories out there involves seismic activity, earthquakes, and undersea tremors. Oarfish in particular have a legendary reputation. In Japanese folklore, these fish are called the messengers from the sea god's palace and are said to wash up before earthquakes. In 2011, before the devastating Tohoku earthquake in Japan, there were reports that an unusual number of oarfish had stranded on beaches. And just before the 7.0 quake in California in 2024, a large oarfish was found dead in shallow water. These anecdotes earned oarfish the nickname Doomsday Fish or Earthquake Fish in media. But is there any truth to it? Scientists have yet to find solid evidence linking oarfish sightings to earthquakes. Correlation is not causation. The Earth has a lot of earthquakes, and the ocean occasionally spits out oarfish. The overlap might be coincidence. That said, it's not entirely implausible that underwater seismic activity could affect deep-sea animals. Fish and other animals can detect vibrations and pressure changes. Some researchers theorize that pre-seismic tremors or releases of gas could cause disorientation or drive deep animals towards the surface. For example, if a small quake under the seafloor releases a burst of methane or CO2, it could alter the water chemistry or buoyancy around the fish, literally lifting it upward or causing it to flee. Or the quake's shockwave might injure or stun the fish, and it then drifts upward in a daze. However, all of this is speculative. Various experts assert that no scientific evidence links oarfish, or any deep-sea fish, to predicting earthquakes. Earthquakes happen suddenly, and it's unclear how a fish could sense one days in advance. It's more likely that both earthquakes and fish strandings can be triggered by a third factor, say a shifting current pattern or underwater disturbance that precedes a quake. In any case, when a big quake hits after an oarfish sighting, people remember the fish and say, "Look, it predicted it." And when an oarfish washes up and nothing happens, well, few take note. Our brains love to connect omens to events. So while the Doomsday Fish makes for a chilling narrative, the scientific consensus leans towards myth over message. The oarfish is not intentionally heralding disaster. Still, it's an area of active curiosity. Maybe these fish are sensitive to things we don't fully understand yet. For now though, if you see an oarfish, don't assume a tsunami is coming. There are more direct reasons the poor creature might be up here, like illness or environmental stress. There's another explanation. Often, the simplest explanation is biological. These animals come up because they're in distress. We touched on this already. An oarfish or anglerfish at the surface is likely disoriented, injured, or dying. When deep-sea fish get sick or old, they can lose the ability to maintain their depth. Many fish have a neutral buoyancy at their preferred depth, through oils, fats, or gas bladders. But if something goes wrong with that system, they might start floating upward uncontrollably, much like a diver losing ballast. Changes in water pressure can also have severe effects. If a deep fish comes up too fast, gases in its body expand, just as a diver can get the bends. Organs can rupture, the swim bladder, if present, can overinflate. The fish may become lethargic or unable to dive back down. It's essentially a form of barotrauma. This is why a lot of deep-sea creatures that we find at the surface are in bad shape. The anglerfish in the Canary Islands likely came up due to some stress. The team speculate possible illness or escaping a predator, and it couldn't survive long in the low-pressure, high-oxygen environment. The moment it reached the surface, its fate was sealed. It died shortly after, and researchers collected the body for study. Same often goes for oarfish. Many of those found at the surface are injured or near death, sometimes bearing wounds from sharks or other predators. In other words, the appearance of these creatures in shallow water is often a distress signal in itself, a sign that they are suffering. It may not always tell us why, The root cause could be internal illness, lack of food, pollution ingestion, you name it. But it's a critical piece of context. These are not healthy animals casually exploring the coast. They are more likely castaways that accidentally wandered into hostile territory. Another reason for these sightings can be predators, prey, and random chance. Nature's chaos. Not every deep sea visitor needs a grand cause like climate or quakes. Sometimes, individual behavior and chance play a role. Deep sea fish do occasionally make vertical migrations, usually at night, to follow prey. The oarfish, for instance, might ascend partway to feed on krill rising towards the surface at dusk, then return to depth before dawn. If one miscalculates or gets too ambitious, it could end up higher than intended. A lancetfish chasing a school of smaller fish could suddenly find itself in the surf zone, tossed by waves onto the beach. Likewise, a deep predator chasing the lancetfish, like a sperm whale or large tuna, could scare it into shallow water. In the open ocean, animals flee upward because there's nowhere else to go but the surface when something chases you from below. In some cases, strong hunger or reproductive drives might lead a deep-sea creature astray. There's also the factor of chance encounters with humans. For example, the only reason we knew about that Canary Island anglerfish is because a group of researchers happened to be in the right place at the right time. How many weird deep-sea fish come near the surface and slip back down unseen? Possibly many. Social media and cameras everywhere mean we catch these events more than we used to, so it can seem like they're increasing. As one scientist noted about the lancetfish strandings, it's not clear if it's happening more frequently or just being noticed more in the age of social media. The ocean has always had its strange moments. We might simply be witnessing them more now. Still, the consensus among experts is that there are underlying trends, warming seas, changing currents, etc., that makes such encounters more likely on top of random chance. Stepping back, what do these rare sightings tell us about the ocean at large? Broadly, they are reminders that the ocean is changing, sometimes in invisible ways, until something dramatic happens. The fact that scientists are actively studying these incidents mean they consider them potential indicators of ecosystem shifts. From a scientific standpoint, these rare encounters are like golden opportunities. Researchers get to examine fresh specimens of species that usually reside in darkness. Museums acquire deep-sea oddities to study their anatomy, DNA, and diet. We glean insights into deep-sea food webs, lifespans, and reproduction from a single animal washed ashore. And maybe, just maybe, we learn how to better protect these creatures and their habitat. After the Canary Islands anglerfish died, it was preserved for science. A sad but invaluable outcome. Likewise, the oarfish in Mexico was sampled by scientists before it disappeared back to sea or perished. Knowledge is being gathered, bit by bit. As our oceans continue to warm and change in the coming years, it's likely we'll hear more stories of strange visitors from the deep. The deep ocean is no longer as distant as we think. Its inhabitants are appearing on our shores, in our news, reminding us that one global ocean connects us all, surface to sea floor.